But my one memory of Lourdes that was just so wonderful was she was a wonderful calligrapher. And when our I was remodeling inside of the church, and I took some marble from the old high altar and the old St. Mary's, and I put it around the existing wood altar, because the marble was just sitting in the garage for many years. But on the front of the altar was this etching. It was like a lamb and a Christian symbol on it that you couldn't see until you were like right up upon it. And so I asked Doris to use her calligraphy skills. I gave her a bucket of gold leaf paint, and I wanted her to just paint that so that it will just pop out and people will be able to see it. And so she did this at the tender age of 84. And I walk into the church, and Doris is lying on her side, looking like somebody should be feeding her grapes or something. Like Cleopatra was lying on her side and just painting there, but she looked like she was in ecstasy. It almost looked like Saint Teresa of Avila in ecstasy that Bernini did that sculpture of, and I was just kidding with her and everything. But when you go to that church and now you see that altar, and from the very front of the church you see that lamb, that Christian symbol popping out, no one is ever going to know who did that. But God knows, and I know, and that is what we are all meant to do: is to be like Doris, to make our Lord more visible for the next generation. Not putting our names on buildings and things like that that will be remembered, because names change. We see that all the time in our culture. We want to get rid of certain names and put up new names and all of that. But the name that we must always remember is Christian. That is who we are, and that's what we must point out to the future generations. And that is what the gospel asks us to do today. Particularly the very end, the last part of today's gospel, is many times the very last words from Scripture that somebody will hear when they are dying. When you give someone last rites, or even the sacrament of anointing of the sick, there's several gospels that you can read for that person, but the first choice is from today's gospel, Matthew 11. And the person hears those comforting words: "Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves, for my yoke is easy and my burden light." If we yoke Jesus with our cancer, with our illness, whatever it is, with our depression, whatever it is that is holding us down that we labor with, Jesus says, "Come, bring it to me, put this upon me, but don't just walk away from me. Be yoked to me." We must be yoked to Jesus, and when you have two animals yoked together, they must work in tandem. And it's not a heavy, burdensome oak yoke that somebody has on, but rather it is very, very light, and we must stay with Jesus. "Come to me, all you labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest." We see continually, week after week, this terrible things going on in our culture at the local level, national and world level. And the problem that people are now facing, it's hard to do in such a pluralistic society, is we have not put God at the center of everything. If we don't love God above all things, we will not be able to love one another. And so when we hear of things that are systemic in our society, we must, as Christians, realize that it is called original sin. It is the concupiscence that we have, which is the disorderedness of all of our good attributes that we have. There's no one that's going to be perfect or saintly, and so the problem that we deal with is the effects of original sin. And to realize that as Christians. And so just a little bit of peace can make the rest of the dough rise up. We as Christians now must put our faith into practice. We must not get sucked up into the negative we must be part of that solution. Things, believe it or not, were much worse in the day of Jesus. That's precisely why the Father sent him into the world at that particular time in the incarnation. And that incarnation continues today. And that is the beautiful thing about our faith. Catholic means universal. It is meant for everyone, and it is throughout the whole world. It's not just for the Irish, or for the Lebanese, or the Italians, or the Polish. It is meant for everyone. And one of the things that divides us in the world today is racism, or that accusation of racism. And you must remember that there are more Catholics of color than any other group in the world. In Africa, in Latin America, in Asia, and so the minority of Christians and Catholics in the world would be folks that are more like the Anglo or the European background. And so it is a melting pot of the church. And that's why the one Latin language that united us for so many centuries was Latin. To realize that we had such different backgrounds and different cultures that we're from, but we have one God. And so anytime the Holy Father, no matter who he is, when he writes something, writes an encyclical or a letter or anything, it is always in Latin, and then it gets translated so it gets out into the world. And so the focus that we have, if you read any of the writings of the Holy Fathers throughout history, but this particularly in our lifetime, since the Second Vatican Council, some of the writings in the Catholic Church are absolutely exquisitely beautiful. People might slam the church because they don't know. They might say about the church's stance on homosexuality, but they've never read any of the encyclicals, particularly Forever Our Children, or some of the apostolic letters written by the Pope or by the bishops. They are absolutely beautiful, and they bring about that kind of healing that the world needs. And so the church has written so much about things like the dignity of labor, about things like marriage, whatever it might be, whatever the hot button topic in the world today is, no one is going to the church or her documents. And certainly they are not going to God. And so more than ever, we need to go to God and to not get sucked up into the negativity of the world, but rather to yoke ourselves to Christ and to be that source of reconciliation and healing. But more than ever, our world needs our prayers. And we have all sorts of things that we're focusing on, all sorts of things that distract us, but we must focus more than ever on changing ourselves, realizing that each and every one of us has been wounded by original sin. And so we carry something with us that is not in union with the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And so we must always remain yoked to Jesus in our workplace, in our home life, in our relationships with others. And if we do that, we would never dream of doing anything contrary to the gospel. But it is an exercise in humility and an exercise in patience. Jesus said we must love God above all things and love our neighbor as ourselves. And as I've said many times before, we don't have to like our neighbor. There's a difference. We go out to eat with people that we like, or we go to concerts, or we hang out with people that we like because they stimulate our mind or our souls. But that doesn't mean they're just like us, not at all. But we must love everybody. And to realize that the problem in the world today is not going to be solved by throwing money at this situation or doing this particular thing. If Jesus Christ is at the center, then we are doomed to keep repeating the same sins of the past. And so we have to do just little simple things, like doors to door. Just as uncomfortable as it might be, just to lie down maybe and on our side and just make things a little bit brighter for others, that they will be able to see Christ a little bit more clearly. And we do so in an anonymous fashion. And so when we receive Holy Communion, as we said before, our venial sins are wiped away every single time that we receive Holy Communion. And that's why it's so important for us to so it's the same thing. When Jesus forgives us our sins, we must do the same. We must be men and women, boys and girls, of forgiveness and reconciliation. Let us not be burdened by the problems or let it